Good evening, everyone. Roots Biotech Private Limited welcomes you all. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar, taking out valuable time from your busy schedule. Roots Biotech is one of the leading providers of innovative solutions to various problems faced in the field by veterinarians. Today, we are presenting management of acute anemic conditions by Dr. Dayaram Suryavanshi, Director, Omega Laboratories. I wish to request you all to keep your microphones on mute. And if you have any questions, please type them into the chat box. Also, we will have time for questions at the end. Dr. Dayaram Suryavanshi, today's speaker, has had an illustrious career with a varied experience. After completing MBSC Pathology from Bombay Veterinary College, he was associated with Bombay Veterinary College as a professor for 8 years. He has also taken a doctorate in veterinary pharmacovigilance. Dr. Dayaram Suryavanshi has a vast experience of 22 years. Sir has carried out more than 2.5 lakh blood sample examinations and more than 13,500 diagnostic post-mortem examinations. Without wasting any more time, I request Dr. Dayaram Suryavanshi to take over. Please bear with us as I share the screen to Sir.
Good evening, everyone. Today we are discussing acute anemia in domestic animals and the complications related to anemia. So as everybody knows, we are in field since last 14 years. Done more than 2.5 lakhs of blood samples and more than 13,500 postmortems, diagnostic postmortems, and we have research collaboration with many national and multinational companies, and we are undertaking so many clinical trials also for various veterinary products. Okay, so for today's topic, we are not discussing so many things which are academic importance, but I'm working in the field, so I will discuss the things which are related to the acute anemia only. So we are talking about anemia, acute anemia, and for today's webinar we are considering the cases less than five gram percent are considered. Then RBC count 2.5 million per cubic millimeter, packed cell volume it's 15%. Then I can give idea about how many cases of acute anemia were noticed in since last 1 year. So here 960 cases of anemia having hemoglobin level between 1 to 3 gram percent, and here you can see the chart: buffalo, ox, sheep and goats. So 960 in cattle, buffalo 90, ox 41, sheep 88, goat 78. So this is the data of hemoglobin level less than one or the in between 1 to 3 gram percent. Then in case of cattle 115 54, then 544, 143, 322 and 233 cases of sheep and goats, the hemoglobin levels were between 3 to 5 gram percent. So today we are discussing these things, different etiological factors for that and how to handle such type of cases. Now, some of the deaths were also observed in the some of the animals. The cattle were died having hemoglobin less than 3 gram percent, 17 cattle, 2 buffaloes, 3 ox, then 22 sheep, 19 goats, and there was mortality in sheep and goats having hemoglobin level 3 to 5 gram percent. So this is about this, some of the data that we have done up till now since last 1 year. Now, acute anemia in dairy cattle, dairy animals. So here, there is a sudden drop in circulating RBC. Then critical phase of hypoxia, more demand of oxygen, chances of sudden collapse, abortion in advanced pregnant animals, severe drop in milk production. These are the, some of the field findings that can be observed during the course of anemia. Acute anemia in dairy animals will be similar like this. So there is a sudden drop in circulating RBC. There is a critical phase of hypoxia. More demand of oxygen is there for the tissues. Then chances of sudden collapse or sudden death are more possible. Then abortion in the advanced pregnant animals is possible, and severe drop in milk production can be observed because of the acute anemia. Now, many times acute anemia is unnoticed in some of the cases. So these are the some of the cases they are having the unnoticed type of anemia. So generally young animals, young growing animals, because farmers are not giving that much more attention towards the growing animals because they are not producing milk. Generally, the health of animal is considered by the farmers depending upon the quantity of milk he get from that particular animal. Then pregnant animals are also generally not looking after by the farmers. So basically the pregnant animals are also may be neglected by the farmers. Then absence or unnoticed typical clinical signs. Sometimes the improper observation may lead to the such type of things. Then large population in the farm. If the farm is of more than 100 animals, 500 animals, 1000 animals, in such cases, there are little chances of observing each and every animals. And if they are particularly non-milking and pregnant animal, these things are happen generally in such big farms. Then per-acute hemolytic disease, some of the diseases which can cause per-acute hemolysis in the animals. Then per-acute conditions of internal hemorrhage. Some of the conditions, they may lead to this extensive bleeding in the internal organs that may lead to the acute anemia. So these are the things can be considered in the field. So that lead to the unnoticed, or that can be called as an unnoticed condition of the acute anemia in the field conditions. Now here we will start the RBCs. So individual RBC or erythron or erythrocytes are having a 70% water and 30% the lipid, iron, globins and other things, 30%, but the 70% of water is there within the RBC. Now here you can see this is a simple diagram. It shows the arterial blood which get the oxygenated RBC, oxygen molecules will be thrown into the tissue fluids for the nutrition purpose as well as the to maintain the integrity of the internal organs. Then the nutrients are also transported from the blood to the tissues. Then as it go towards the venule side, capillaries. So slowly there is the incorporation of the carbon dioxide, then the incorporation of the waste material, and the less amount of oxygen will be there towards the venous side. So this is a normal circulatory mechanism that can be observed. It is in the simple form. Now mechanism of oxygen transport. So here regularly 90 to 98% of the oxygen is transported by the hemoglobin. Whatever the hemoglobin is present in the RBC, it carries oxygen with them. 2 to 10% of oxygen is suspended in plasma. 2 to 8% of oxygen is suspended in plasma. So both of these oxygen will reach to the cell or the wherever it is required. So ultimately, you can see this diagram. If this is one RBC, it's having the oxygen, hemoglobin plus oxygen here. So from RBC, there is a release of oxygen at the tissue level in the plasma, get dissolved in the plasma and go to the cell. Along with that, the carbon dioxide will suspended into the interstitial fluid, will be absorbed into this plasma, and again it will go to the RBC and it will transport it towards the lungs. So this is the simple phenomenon of the oxygen and carbon dioxide transportation at the cellular level or the at the tissue level. So this is the feature of the transportation of the oxygen. Then mechanism of anemia. So mechanism, it is simply, so I am not going for the typical type of the academic classification of anemia. So here mechanism of anemia that we are observing at the field, so intravascular destruction of RBC, then extravascular destruction of RBC, and immunological or combined immunological type of anemia that can be observed at the field conditions. Now here again the simple diagram of the same thing. So this is a normal RBC, may be sensitized by the any antigen, then it get absorbed or the it get fixed by antigen, and these antigens with the antibodies they can remove the RBC from circulation. So here pre-sensitization to the penicillin may be required. Then likewise the other drugs, they may be when they present over the surface of RBC, they may destroy the RBC by hemolysis or by phagocytosis. So this in the field conditions we are not able to identify is it by the phagocytosis or is it by the hemolysis, but the ultimate result of the everything is the anemia. So different kinds of anemia may be observed, maybe hemolytic, hemorrhagic, or hemorrhagic and hemolytic type of anemia can be observed at the field level. So it may be immunological, non-immunological, and or the it is a combination of the both the things. Now we'll see different conditions of the intravascular hemolysis that are very commonly observed in the field conditions. So intravascular hemolysis with the release of hemoglobin into plasma. So whenever there is a lysis of RBC, definitely the hemoglobin will be released in the plasma. Then free hemoglobin in the plasma binds formation of a complex that is called as a hemoglobin heptaglobulin complex. It is cleared by plasma or the whatever the complex are formed, it is get cleared by the liver. So to prevent, once there is a formation of hemoglobin and heptaglobulin complex, these complexes go to the liver, and from liver there is a disintegration of this complex. The hemoglobin and heptaglobin complex go to the liver to restore the some of the hemoglobin concentration within the body. Then the excess of complex more than 150 mg per deciliter lead to hemoglobinuria. Now in many conditions this may be observed that the blood smear may be positive for Babesia, but animal is not showing the hemoglobinuria. The reason is that there is a threshold level of the 150 mg of this complex. The complex when go beyond 150 mg that lead to the hemoglobinuria. So the capacity of liver, in the simple language we can say the capacity of liver to combat with the this complex is 150 mg per deciliter, and if the concentration is go beyond this, then that lead to the hemoglobinuria. Now this is a diagrammatic presentation of the destruction of RBC. So this rupture of RBC may be due to anything, maybe the antibodies, maybe the complement which are formed during the acute phase of inflammation. So that lead to the destruction of RBC. The output of that, the hemoglobin is suspended into the plasma. With the time, this free hemoglobin which dissociated to form a free ferriheme which complex with the beta globulin and hemopexin. Now hemoglobin that passes into the glomerulus, so whatever the complexes which are remain by the or the get free by the liver, that will they will reach to the kidney for the filtration rate. So the pre filtrate of the hemoglobin will reaches to the proximal tubules of the kidney. Some of that will be get absorbed by the kidney, and then unabsorbed hemoglobin passes into the urine, causes hemoglobinuria. So the first, the conservative type of things that is observed because of the liver. So first, liver try to maintain the hemoglobin level within the body or the within the blood. After that, the concentration of these molecules or the complex goes beyond 150 mg, then the remaining portion will reaches to the kidney. When it reaches to the kidney, again some of the portion is get absorbed, and once it is more than that, then that will lead to the hemoglobinuria. Then some of the hemoglobin will retain into the epithelial cells and will be converted into the hemosiderin, or there is a formation of hemosiderin. So sometimes there is a hemosiderinuria can be observed. The color of such type of urine is it's not coffee color or not port wine color. It little bit having the some orange type of tinge to that. So such type of urine can also be observed in the hemoglobinuria or the acute hemolytic conditions in the animals. Now etiology for the acute hemolytic anemia, very commonly observed in sheep and goat, the Clostridium hemolyticum, as well as in the large animals also. Clostridium hemolyticum, Clostridium novae, these two species are most importantly observed. In other complication can be observed because of the other clostridial species together. Then very common conditions, the Babesia, then snake poison or the snake venoms, then the plant poison, basically onion. Then incompatible transfusion. Sometimes the incompatible transfusion can be observed, and it is very rare, but it may happen in the field conditions sometimes. Then neonatal hemolysis, that is also common in horses, but very rare in the dairy animals. Then hypoosmolarity, the osmotic pressure of the RBCs get changed. So that may be changed because of the excess of water intake. Then hypotonic solution intravenous. Then postpartum hemoglobinuria. So these are the things that lead to the acute hemolysis. Clostridial species, Babesia, incompatible transfusions, then neonatal hemolysis, hypoosmolarity of the RBC, maybe due to the water, then hypotonic solutions, postpartum hemoglobinuria. So these are the conditions which lead to the acute hemolytic anemia in case of the animals. So these are the pictures of the Babesia. You can see many RBCs are infected with the Babesia parasite. Now here you can see a typical picture of the ischemic necrosis of the liver. So here these areas are indication of the ischemic area of liver and generally occur because of the clostridial infection. Now here some of the conditions that lead to the combination of the both the things, the leptospirosis and Clostridium, that is very commonly observed in the sheep and goat. Clostridial species plus Leptospira both together will lead to the very extensive type of damage to the liver, then the circulatory RBCs, and ultimately the more than 20 to 30% of deaths are observed yearly. So those peoples maybe around this area, they are knowing early rainy seasons, these type of problems are there in our area. So typical Leptospira case, you can see this kind of livers are there. Now here you can see edema formation due to the acute anemia. You can see the color of edematous fluid is reddish one. So whenever there is a hemolytic type of anemia is there, so definitely you will have edema of the almost all part of the body, and the edematous fluid is of reddish in color in most of the hemolytic conditions. So all hemolytic conditions will have this kind of hemolysis, maybe liver, maybe the peritoneal cavity, maybe the in all this condition there is a effusion of this kind of reddish type of fluid. It may be called as serosanguineous type of fluid in the body cavities, in the organs. So these are the things that can be observed in the acute hemolysis in the animals. Now we'll shift towards the extravascular hemolysis. Extravascular hemolysis can be observed in case of filariasis, anaplasmosis, trypanosoma, penicillin sensitization, then disseminated intravascular coagulopathies, autoimmune hemolytic anemia, and sometimes the vaccine reaction may lead to the autoimmune hemolytic anemia in some of the cases, but this is the rare thing. The mechanism of the extravascular hemolysis is again the simple mechanism. So first, antigen should be there. Antigen should adsorb, or it should be adhere to the surface of RBC. Then RBC will become sensitized. These sensitized RBCs also opsonize, or there is an opsonization of the infected RBC. Then these infected RBCs are recognized by the mononuclear phagocytic system. And once they are recognized by the mononuclear phagocytic system, these RBCs are removed from the circulation. Either it is from the spleen, if the capacity of spleen is over, then some lymph nodes, and at last liver may do the function of the extravascular hemolysis in case of infection that we have already discussed, the filaria, anaplasma, trypanosoma, penicillin, disseminated intravascular coagulopathies, autoimmune hemolytic anemias, then vaccine reaction. So in all this condition, the RBCs are sensitized. These sensitized RBCs are removed by the circulation. The procedure of the sensitization is opsonization. After opsonization, these RBCs are recognized by the mononuclear phagocytic system. And once they are detecting the mononuclear phagocytic system, these RBCs are removed from the circulation, either from spleen, lymph nodes, and liver. So you can see the thylaria. Another picture of thylaria. Then anaplasmosis. So these are the conditions that lead to the extravascular hemolysis in the animals. Now the next complication may be the surgical complications. So as we are working in field, I may came across many times such type of conditions. So hyperexcitability of the animal. If the animals are hyperexcited, so many times at the time of doing the operations, animals may suddenly walk up and run away. So these things may happen. Then suddenly hyperexcitability may lead to the fracture of the other parts of the body. So these things is generally commonly observed in the animals during the surgical interventions in the field conditions. Then clotting defects. If the animals are having less platelets, less thrombocytic factors, then the less clotting factors, the improper liver function or the liver dysfunction, then long-standing disorders may lead to the imperfect suturing, ligation. Example, a very good example is the long-standing dystochia, and ultimately you go for the cesarean section for the same type of uterus, then that may lead to the you are not able to take a proper sutures when you have taken the cut. So this is because of the excessive accumulation of the edematous fluid. Then the we are not able to make sutures into that, and that sutures may get tear. So along with that tearing, there is a rupture of some of the blood vessels, and that may lead to the acute type of anemia. Then in fracture cases also, that can be observed in the animals because we are not able to restrain animal very properly after surgical interventions. So sometimes due to the pain, animal is having some stretching type of things, maybe the walking, maybe the running. So in that case, the fractures again refracture, and the surrounding tissues become destructed by the bony spicules of the fracture, and ultimately that lead to the extensive bleeding and hemorrhages. So these are the complications can be observed during the surgeries. Then acute internal bleeding can be observed in the many conditions. Rupture of major blood vessels. Major blood vessels may be rupture. Rupture of uterus during the handling dystochia. If the more weight of fetus is there, then the over handling of the uterus may lead to the rupture of uterus and lead to the extensive bleeding into the intestine, into the abdominal cavity. That can be observed because of the dystochia. Then ulceration. So generally thylaria and long-standing use of the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs that lead to the ulceration into the abomasum. And once the ulcers are formed into the abomasum, there are extensive bleeding into the ulcers, and the condition we are calling is as a melena. So the tarry color fecal samples are there. So the fecal material is there. That is because of the ulceration. Then clotting defects. Then migratory fasciolar spaces. So this is also very common. Then the penetrating foreign bodies. Sometimes the foreign bodies may directly penetrate into the heart. The cardiac tamponade may be observed, and animal may suddenly collapse because of these kind of conditions. So acute penetrating foreign bodies. Then the atherosclerosis. It is very commonly observed in the buffaloes, especially. They are having the high producing milk. So generally these buffaloes are fed with the poor quality of oils, then poor quality of the bypass fat. So in that conditions, there is a atherosclerosis. Major blood vessels, they are affected by this, and extensive bleeding can be observed because of the rupture of the atheros or the atheromas. And finally, the generally animals found dead after milking. So after milking, so if the buffalo is giving around 12 liters of the milk or 13 liters of milk, and after giving milk, the animal just suddenly collapse. And when we did the postmortem, we found that the extensive amount of blood was observed in the thoracic cavity and somewhere in the abdominal cavity. And when you reached to the particular location, we found that the most of the major arteries or the aortas branches, they are affected by the atherosclerosis, and that was observed because of the feeding of the excess of the bad quality oil, poor quality bypass fat, and that lead to the atheromas or the atherosclerosis in the buffaloes, and that is very common in the Mumbai and around areas. Here I can show some videos of the acute blood loss in case of fasciola. You can see the extensive blood is coming through the abdominal cavity. This is from the sheep. You can see, so extensive amount of blood is there in the abdominal cavity. The whole abdominal cavity is filled with the blood only. So extensive amount of blood loss. So such animals are collapsed suddenly within a fraction. There is a formation of multiple hemorrhages into the liver and peritoneal cavity because of the migratory parasites, and that lead to the extensive loss of blood. So here you can see the how much blood is lost from that particular animal. Here again another case of the same kind of picture. So extensive blood loss. So here blood is not oozed because the most of the blood is converted into the blood clots. The same thing is here. So you can see the large amount of blood clots are observed in the abdominal cavity, and it is because of the same thing, the migratory parasites. That migratory parasite lead to the extensive damage to the liver, and ultimately the extensive loss of blood is there. Extensive extravascular damage or the extravasation of blood is there, or acute anemia can be observed because of this condition. Now accident, it's a very common. Road accidents are there, the all type of mechanical injury, the excitement fractures are there. Generally that is observed in the desi animals. So excitement of the animals due to the any strange sounds, or animals suddenly walk up, run away, and ultimately maybe get fractured, and extensive blood loss is there and may die because of the severe anemia. Then some of the deficiencies of vitamin K, then copper, iron, the RBC maturation factor, all these conditions lead to the acute type of anemia in case of the animals. Now we'll shift towards the typical signs of anemia. There are different types of, or the signs of anemia. Everybody are master in this, so I'm not going to tell anything special in this. So mucous membranes may be pale, may be reddish, may be synovial, may be ectaric. So depending upon the etiological factors, you can see the pale mucous membrane generally observed in case of the internal bleeding. So if the mucous membranes are look like a boiled eggs or the egg white, then you can see this is because of the internal bleeding. Then if it is reddish, we can say the hemolysis is there. Then synovial may be in case of the snake bites. Then the ectaric may be observed in the mixed infection of the thylaria, anaplasma, then the leptospirosis. In leptospira, the intensity of ecthyrosis is much more than the other conditions. So it's like a turmeric, or the extensive pink color, sorry, extensive yellow color will be observed. I will show some of the photographs later on. Then urine some of the conditions, the red color urine, dark yellow color urine, poppy color urine, port wine color urine. So these are the typical type of urines can be observed. So urine may be red, urine may be dark yellow in case of jaundice. Then coffee colored, babesia, port wine colored, babesia. Then hyperpnea. So after that, the hyperpnea is because the same reason. So body required more oxygen to give demands, or the two because of that, as the body required more oxygen, and in response to the hypoxia, there is a hyperpnea. Then tachycardia, respiratory distress is there, salivation is there, cupping is there. Now salivation and cupping, these two clinical signs can be observed because of the accumulation of edematous fluid into the body cavities, especially in the thoracic cavity, as well as into the alveoli interstitial space. And because of the, there is a change in the osmotic pressure, the accumulation of edematous fluid is observed. ultimately there is a permission of prod due to the churning of ear, and it will come through the mouth. So in case of some of the acute anemic cases, you can see the salivation, or that there is a smashing type of saliva is accumulated around the commissures. Then cupping is there because of the same reason, the accumulation of edematous fluid and the froth is there. Then fever, sometimes in acute conditions there is a fever and followed by change in fever, or there is no fever, and sometime animal may sit down. So in acute anemic conditions this may be observed. So whenever the extensive blood loss is there, animal will lose its body temperature. It could be observed many times. So there is a once there is a extensive loss of blood, they sometimes animal may sit down. So this also another complications can be observed due to the anemia. Then fatigue, obviously fatigue will be there, and sometimes the collapse of the animal is there whenever there is an acute hemorrhagic anemia is there. So just we have observed the one video. In such conditions, animal will die suddenly. Then those animals in production will drop in milk production suddenly. Get abortion in advanced pregnant animals. So these are the conditions can be observed in case of the anemia, or the these are the clinical signs can be observed in the anemia. So here the color of urine is a poppy color urine, you can say. Then the mucous membranes, or the you can see thylaria. So the icterus is there. The yellow discoloration of the all internal organs, the adipose tissues, subcutaneous tissue, mucous membranes, all are the icteric in conditions. Now here you can see the leptospira, very typical type of things. Here I have shown the liver, sorry, lungs and surrounding tissues, they have become extensively icteric. So you can see the like a turmeric, the when we mix turmeric in water, it will give you the similar kind of picture in case of the leptospirosis. Now anaplasma and thylaria, so combination of the both the things. But on the in live animals we are not able to differentiate, so for that purpose we need some laboratory investigation for that. So in thylaria you can see the icteric, but the at the little bit more intensity of the yellow discoloration. Then sudden death in some of the severe anemic conditions, the acute hemorrhage, accident, fistula, internal bleeding, snake bite. So this is about the conditions that lead to the acute blood loss, either by the hemorrhages or hemolysis. Then the snake bite also, sudden death can be observed because of snake bite also. The poisons like onion poison, snake bite, that lead to the sudden death in the animals. Now after that, the after completion of the etiological factors, we will shift ourselves towards the different managemental aspect of the anemia. So the clinically we can diagnose this is the case of anemia, but we are not able to diagnose this is a case of leptospira on the field basis. Then we can able to diagnose the thylaria, babesia, anaplasma, then the ehrlichia. All these conditions can be observed because with the help of blood smear examination. You have to just take a peripheral blood smear, go for the Leishman stains or Jimsa stain, and we'll observe the different type of parasites. Then we'll go for the differential diagnosis. And finally, the ultimate thing is that it's not a diagnosis, it's a diagnosis plus treatment. So the how to manage the acute anemia, anemic cases in field condition is most important. Because we have very less resources with us, we don't have much more facility when we are working in the field. So we are discussing such things that can be helpful for the we people as well as for the farmers also. Now here the how to go for the management of the acute anemia. So first thing is that we should go accurate etiological factors. So accurate etiological factors, so that includes the history, clinical science, specific science. Now history, so history is most important in case of the poisons and the snake bites, the poisons and snake bites. So we can go in that directions. Then clinical science for the thylaria, we know that you are getting the typical type of pulsation at the paralumbar fossa. Then the enlargement of lymph nodes, maybe the prescapular, suprascapular or the supramammary lymph nodes are enlarged. Then the specific signs, that includes the maybe the red color urine, maybe the port wine color urine. So these are the things you can able to diagnose. Then the phosphorus deficiency, the Babesia phosphorus deficiency. In Babesia, definitely we have the high height of temperature is there. Then there is no clear cut demarcation for the when it will be observed. So Babesia can be observed anytime, but the postparturant hemoglobin urea can be observed after the delivery of the cow. So these are the things should be considered for the these things for the detection of specific etiological factors. And no doubt the final conclusions of the etiological factors can be observed with the help of laboratory. So in laboratory you will able to find the pyroplasms, then the Babesia, then the anaplasma. And if the anaplasma is absent, Babesia. Now the problem is with the leptospira. The peripheral blood smear is negative for Tularemia, negative for Babesia, negative for anaplasma, then negative for Ehrlichia. Till there is a persistent fever, but the animal is showing the ecteric type of signs, the typical yellow, the turmeric yellow type of mucous membranes are there. Then such type of cases are suspected for the leptospirosis. Then for the leptospira, you must have some history of the presence of rat around your area. Rat must be there in that particular area, or from where the farmers are bringing the green powders or the powders. Then you must see some of the storage places of the farmers where they are putting their ingredients or the storage of the food. And if you are having the so many holes of the parasites, in such so many holes for the rats, then you can suspect there is a leptospirosis. Then the free ranging dogs, if they are moving in the farm, that is also the source of infection for the large animal. So the clinical history, then the clinical signs, with the help of laboratory investigations, whenever there is the absence of the blood parasite within the blood smear, then you can go towards your diagnosis towards the leptospirosis. So this is nothing but the detection of the accurate etiological agent. And once we know the exact causative factors, then we can go for the specific treatment. Then the another complication that observed in the field condition, that is a bacillary hemoglobinuria and Babesia. So bacillary hemoglobinuria, will get the hemoglobinuria, but in peripheral blood smear you will not get any Babesia. Then blood smear examination or the total leukocyte count will be high, and comparatively there is a neutrophilia will be there. Then you will have no blood parasite or the no Babesia into the peripheral blood smear. Then you can shift yourself towards the bacillary hemoglobinuria, and in the both the condition there is a high fever. Then if you want some further investigation, you can go for the culture of urine, and through the culture of urine you will able to identify the bacteria or the bacterial colonies that can give additional support to you for the diagnosis of the case. Then after detection of etiology, you should go for the specific treatment. Say for example, if you detect the Tularemia, you have to go for the specific treatment of the Tularemia. Then another treatment aspect, the Babesia is there, you should go for the specific Babesia treatment. Then after that, you should go for the correction of oxygen demand, whatever the body required oxygen, and we have to try to correct the oxygen demand of the body. Then control of the pathogenesis of the disease by supportive and corrective treatment. So corrective treatment and supportive treatment, so both are required. So corrective treatment and supportive treatment for the maintenance of the oxygen demand in the body. Then appropriate follow-up treatment. So after doing the basic treatment or major treatment, you should go for the specific type of follow-up. So maybe the liver tonic, maybe the hematinics, everything should be included in that. So once we give the injection of buparvaquone, generally we are not able to, or we are not giving much more emphasis on the post treatment aspect or the follow-up treatment. So if you are giving follow-up, very good follow-up, the recovery is ultimately very good. Then specific, we will discuss about the specific treatment. specific treatment of for the thalassemia. So bupivacaine, I will give a specific name over here, the bupivacaine plus furosemide or the Zubion F. It has given very good result for the lung edema cases. Then oxytetracycline for the thalassemia. Then babesia, dimazine, maybe imidacloprid. Along with that, you must give the phosphorus. So this is about the specific treatment of thalassemia. No doubt we are again going towards the different aspect of the treatment also. So I am talking about the only specific treatment for the some specific conditions. So the thalassemia, bupivacaine, and bupivacaine plus furosemide or the Zubion F specifically. Then oxytetracycline for the thalassemia, babesia, you may go for the dimazine, you may go for imidacloprid. Along with that, you should give the phosphorus. So along with that, I will give one clinical trial report to you, because it will be helpful for you people, because whenever you are getting such type of very acute cases of the anemia and caused by the thalassemia. Now, in every anemic conditions, there is a formation of lung edema. Now, say for example, if the anemia is because of the thalassemia, so in thalassemia cases, there is a formation of lung edema. So the lung edema is basically observed because of there is a decrease in a colloidal osmotic pressure, and due to decrease in a colloidal osmotic pressure due to the severe anemia. So once there is a severe anemia, there is a lung edema formation. Once lung edema is there, there is a improper oxygenation. Oxygen transportation is very improper. Then once there is a lung edema formation, there is a chances of enhancement of the complication of anemia. So already and body condition of the or the tissue of the body are in a stress, but ultimately if the lung edema is developed again, cells are undergoing the stress. So the lung edema will enhance the complication of the anemia. Then I have conducted the clinical trials on 117 samples cases of the severe anemia having the 1 to 3 gram percent of the hemoglobin and given the Zubion F in that condition. So that gives a better result, and so ultimately that is because of the whatever the interstitial fluids get accumulated or interstitial edematous fluids get accumulated, that has been removed with the help of F or the furosemide, which is present into the Zubion F. So that gives the better result in case of the acute thalassemia cases. Then specific treatment for anaplasma, you may go for the oxytetracycline and imidacloprid. Then Clostridium, specific drug of choice for the Clostridial infection is a streptopenicillin. And then the drug of choice for the leptospirosis is a streptopenicillin, oxytetracycline and doxycycline. So you should go for the doxycycline, maybe the oxytetracycline and streptopenicillin for 4-5 days. Then we are getting read up from the leptospirosis. Then for fasciola, you should go for the specific treatment of the ivermectin plus chlorzolone. Without chlorzolone, the immature fasciola will not be die. So for the immature fasciolosis, we should go for the ivermectin plus chlorzolone. Then for onion poisoning, the vitamin C, phosphorus, antioxidants and fluids should be given. You may get recovery within the 3 to 4 days. Then snake bites, you should go for, or the we must go for the polyvalent anti-snake venoms. Then trypanosoma, you may go for dimazine, then the nizom, triquin, nilberry, and along with that, you should go for the dextrose. So we must give dextrose to the such animals. Then in case of vaccine reaction followed by anemia, so we should go for the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, antioxidants, sometimes steroids, antihistamines, phosphorus to avoid the loss of RBCs. So these are the things can be done for the vaccine reaction. Then DIC, identification of the specific etiological factors. Then we must go for the antihistamines, steroids, fluids, the heparins, or the vitamin K, ascorbic acids, hemostat. Depending upon the situation and depending upon the condition of the animals, DIC generally is a very complicated case and can be observed in dairy animals. And mainly, it is having the multifactorial type of infections and lead to the acute anemia in case of the animals. Now, unusual conditions that may lead to the acute anemia and very commonly observed in the field. So, red milk. So, throughout milking, the color of milk is red in color. Then melena. So as we discussed earlier, melena is because of the extensive loss of blood into the ulcerations observed because of the NSID or the thylaria. Then epistaxis, maybe because of the internal injury to the nasal passage, maybe the fungal infections, maybe granulomas, maybe tumors. So all these conditions lead to the epistaxis, and uncontrolled type of bleeding can be observed. Then sometimes head injury into the frontal sinus, that lead to the extensive bleeding, and we are not able to find out the cause of the this thing. So ultimately epistaxis is one of the clinical signs can be observed into the head injury or the frontal sinus injury. Then the granulomas, then the granulomas observed because of the fungal infections. Then other nasal granulomas, they can be observed because of the schistosomiasis in case of animals. Then summer dysentery, generally in summer dysentery we will get the red color blood throughout, red color here, not tarry color, it is red. A frank of blood or the fresh blood can be observed into the summer dysentery. So these are the conditions, unusual conditions which lead to the extensive blood loss in through the feces. Now treatment for the milk or the red milk, so we should go for the vitamin K, ascorbic acid, tranexamic acid. Then we may go for the doxycycline, oxytetracycline, streptopenicillin with the excess of fluids. Now why doxycycline, why oxytetracycline, or why streptopenicillin? Because it was observed that the red milk is associated with the leptospirosis. Red milk is associated with the chronic leptospirosis. So it is one of the common conditions or the common problems observed in the field conditions. So one of the reason is the leptospira. So considering that this could be the because of leptospira, we may go for the along with the specific treatment of the to stop blood. So vitamin K, ascorbic acid, tranexamic acid, then the doxycycline, you may go for the oxytetracycline, streptopenicillin, and along with that you must give the some excess of fluids. Then melina, for melina we should go for the H2 blockers, ranitidine, pantoprazole, omeprazole, along with that vitamin K, tranexamic acid, and ethambutolate. So anything can be given along with H2 blockers. Epistaxis, the same treatment along with the other hemostat. But if you are able to diagnose it is fungal, then you can go for the fluconazole tablets or the fluconazole. Then summer dysentery, you can go same type of hemostat, metronidazole, ceftriaxone sulbactam, then orally oxytetracycline and pyrazolidone, etc. can be given for the control of the summer diarrhea or summer dysentery. You can see the color of milk is like this. Red color milk can be observed in case of the long-standing case of leptospira. Then general management for the improvement of the oxygen demands. So here we very much interested in this. So important thing, the blood transfusion. So then we can go for the compatibility of the blood transfusion. So it having the two, the major, minor, and third one is a cold type of antigen. So major cross match test the erythrocytes of the donor against the serum or plasma of the recipient, and the minor compatibility is the cross matches the test of the it tests the serum or plasma of the donor with the RBC. Minor cross matches the tests or serum of the serum or plasma of the donor against the erythrocytes of the recipients. And along with that, we should go for the compatibility at 4 degrees centigrade to identify the some of the cold antigens which are present over the surface of RBC. Now here I can give example of the VCBT. So it is one common conditions or the common requirement of the field veterinarians is a blood bag which are required for the transfusion of the blood. Now it is suggested that after transfusion of the blood, you may go for the intravenous Arbipurone injection plus dextrose 25% along with the it will give the excellent result. Now the iron dextran, generally peoples are using the human preparations, and it is also costly. So around 250 rupees per 2 ml. But the if you go for the Arbipiron, so it is having the 50 mg concentration per ml. So if you you 10 ml, 20 ml, 30 ml, definitely it will save the life of animal. I will give some clinical data as well as I made some of the publications for the same thing. So after blood transfusion, it is advisable to give Arbipiron plus dextrose 25% intravenously. It will give excellent results. Then instead of using 2 ml preparation of the human beings, so we should go for the directly you can use the 10 ml and 10 into 50. So it's a 500 mg of the iron dextran will be available for the cattle or the animals. If you you can give the 10 ml, 20 ml, 30 ml, some of the practitioners nowadays they are giving 60 ml also. So till they are saying that after giving 60 ml, we are getting the we are not getting any adverse reaction with the Arbipiron injections. Now intravenous iron dextran. Now the blood bag is okay. Blood bags are available, but wherever the blood bags are not available. So since last 10 years, I am using the Arbipiron because we are not getting blood bags at that time. So when we want to do the blood transfusion, we have to rush towards the human blood banks, and it's very quite difficult to get blood blood back from the human blood banks, and it was a very tedious type of job and hectic job. And after that, many legislations come and they are not giving free blood bags to the anyone. So we are in a very dilemma, not getting proper results. So after that, I starting this thing. So since last 10 years, I am using Arbipiron plus dextrose 25% or 50% dextrose intravenously in the animals. So at that time, we are not getting blood bags. So we have started this type of therapies. Then clinical trials was conducted on severely anemic cases, hemoglobin level less than 4 g/cl in case of Babesia. So whenever there was Babesia, there was 88% recovery. So 22% we are not getting recovery from that because the hemoglobin level went more than or less than 1 g/cl or about 1 to 2 g/cl. So in such cases, we are not getting that much of recovery. That's why the recovery rate for this was 88% in the very, very acute anemic conditions. Then the clinical signs or the clinical trials was conducted on severely anemic cases having the hemoglobin level less than 4 g/cl. Here we are getting in thalassemia, it has been written Babesia, but it is thalassemia. So in thalassemia cases, the recovery rate was the 96%. So there was, you can see the one chart over here. So since last year, 3 years, I am sharing data with you people. So 987 cases total, and you can see died cases. So the thalassemia cases, this bar of thalassemia, this bar is of the Babesia. So 987 cases of thalassemia, 311 cases of the Babesia. Then the you can see there is a recovery of 957 cases. Then the 271 cases from the anemia. No doubt. Along with that, we have to give a specific treatment. Only Arbipiron intravenous is not sufficient. Along with that, you should go for the specific treatment that we have discussed earlier. So this is a image of the Arbipiron. So we can use this Arbipiron intravenously, and this was the result observed since last 3 years. And this is a 3-year data indicating that there is a 88% recovery from cases of Babesia because there is extensive hemolysis, but that much of extravascular hemolysis is not observed in thalassemia. That's why recovery rate or the chances of recovery are very common or they're very great in case of the thalassemia cases. So the intravenous iron dextran. So ultimately you can go for the either in the 25% or 50% of dextrose intravenously, and you will get optimum result, and you will not able to die, or you are not giving death of the animals, or you can save the life of the animal. Now follow-up therapy. So after this clinical trial data, the follow-up therapy was it is regular. You can give two boluses of Arbipiran orally. Then these are the indications and content of the Arbipiran. You can see different aspects of the Arbipiran. Then other supportive treatment, you can go for liver tonics. Then you can go for the butaphospan, cyanocobalamin, live yeast culture, energy saline, antioxidants. So all these are needed for the sperm, specific type of conditions, specific type of etiological factors, and definitely we will able to save the life of the animal. Then the another complication or the complementary things, the Hibex will give most of the things which is required for the recovery during the anemia phase. Hibex bolus, as it is having the potent hepatoprotective activity, then blend of the B complex and the live yeast culture, MOAS, everything is there. So it is another best solution for the supportive treatment along with the specific treatment and intravenous iron dextran. Yeah, here Hibex bolus, already we have discussed this Hibex bolus somewhere else in the last webinar. Now some of the peoples, they are using these things, the plasma expanders to control the anemia. Plasma expander to control the anemia. Is it having any role? So I will say there is no role of such plasma expander to control the anemia. Now these plasma expanders will be useful for the whenever there is an exudative type of lesions or exudative type of defects are there in the body. So this plasma expander is having the blend of amino acids, and this blend, within that blend we require a proline and cysteine. So where it is required? Actually, these proline and cysteines are required for the maintenance of the formation of extracellular matrix of the vascular endothelial cells. Now, whenever there is a damage to the vascular endothelial cells due to the multiple reasons, many reasons, in that conditions, we may require the blend of plasma expanders or the blend of amino acids, and within that, we require the proline and cysteine, but it doesn't have any role in the anemia. So plasma expander doesn't serve anything for the anemia cases. So better you can go for the Arbipiran IV, you will get a proper result. Then this is recommended in the plasma expanders are recommended in burn cases where there is a exudation is there and there is a continuous healing process are required. For the every healing procedure, there is a requirement of extracellular matrix, and extracellular matrix will be formed with the help of proline and cysteine only. So for that purpose, we can go for the plasma expanders. Then there is no role in the enhancement of the oxygen transports and iron metabolism. So the plasma expanders, they doesn't have any role in the anemia cases, except whenever there is a damage to the vascular endothelial cells and exudation is there. In such cases, you can use the plasma expanders. Okay, so all this about the acute anemia and its conditions, you can contact for the Arbipiran to Roots Biotech. And finally, this is my number. You can contact for the me for the any further discussion or the any other things. So thank you very much. Now I will go through the your questions. Okay, someone is asking the phosphorus in which form, pyopora or butaphospan. So it's depend upon the conditions in which you require the phosphorus. So you may go for the elemental phosphorus also. You may go for the tolidiphos, or you may go for the sodium acid phosphate. So either it's a choice, but depending upon the hemoglobin concentration, the requirement and the use of butaphospan. Now generally butaphospan and cyanocobalamin can be given as a routine treatment aspect of the any disease. So you can give phosphorus. So in along with anemia, you can give the phosphorus or the butaphospan with cyanocobalamin. You can go for tolidiphos also. Then you can go intravenous elemental phosphorus whenever there is extensive hemolysis is there, maybe because of the hypophosphatemia. So you can go for the either sodium acid phosphate or the elemental type of phosphorus. So that is again your choice, but the elemental phosphorus will give better result along with this for the intravascular hemolysis, basically hypophosphatemia cases. The next question, the in case of filariasis, can you use IV fluids administered oxy? Yes, we can give oxy intravenously, no problem in that. So as I doing the filaria cases since last 13 years, and I am using 100 ml or more than that oxy tetracycline intravenously along with the fluids, there is no any harm, and till I have not any found the death of the animal because of the giving oxy tetracycline. But if the severe condition, anemic condition is there, so it's better you can use the some furosemide, and then you can go for the intravenous oxy tetracycline. It is no harm, but my personal experience say that instead of long acting oxygen oxy tetracycline, intravenous 100 ml oxy will give better result. Oxy tetracycline 100 ml will give better result than the long acting oxy tetracycline. Parenteral dose of rantidine, so we can give 20 ml of the parenteral dose of the rantidine around for the large animal. 20 ml of the rantidine can be given for the as a parenteral dose for the animals. Okay, so Arbipiran, one or two cases may die, but you may having bad experience, it's okay. But till I have said about more than 88% of the cases of the anemia and 96% of the cases of the filaria in case of up till now. So one or two cases may died. The another reasons may be there. So it not maybe not be because of the Arbipiran. Okay, so that can be observed. So you may go for postmortem examination. Then we are able to find out the exact cause of the death of that particular animal. But as it is, it didn't show any kind of things up till now. Then how to diagnose fascial and field conditions? Generally, field conditions, immature fasciolysis cannot be diagnosed. Just you must have history. And you may go for the postmortem examination, specifically in case of the sheep and goat. No doubt, the cattle are also affected, but the all these cattle will have the history of the grazing somewhere around the waterlogging conditions. The paddocks or the ponds are there. In that conditions, there are chances of the fasciolar infections. You can go for the some representative postmortem, and you can give the specific treatment for the that particular flock. Okay, so availability of Arbipiran, you may contact the route personnel.
About Zolanto.
Okay, so I have given answer for the no doubt the for every injection. Sometimes you get death also with the oxy also. Is it true? So you may get death by the oxy also, but it's okay. So any same thing with the penicillin also. So you may have, because in our India the pharmacovigilance is not up to the mark. So that's why we are not talking much more things on this. So definitely we'll discuss these things later on. But definitely the any xenobiotic or any medicines, if the animal is sensitized, definitely death will be occur, but we should go for the other investigations as well as the postmortem examinations of that particular animal. Maybe having the prior myocardial injury. So in myocardial injury, such type of things can be observed. So you might have done the postmortem. If you have did the postmortem, just try to share the postmortem photos to me. So that will be better for both of us. Anabolic steroids in anemia, generally already liver in stress condition, but during the recovery you can give anabolic steroids, but with the cautions. Okay, parasitic anemia can be observed and happens, and how to treat, because the parasitic anemia, today we have not discussed the parasitic anemia because it is not an acute anemia, it is a long standing chronic anemia. So parasitic will have some diarrhea, the low wasting conditions, you can see the slowly there is a deterioration of condition, diarrhea is there, and the you may get the some pot-bellied appearance, submandibular edema will be there. And ultimately, by the fecal sample examination, you will be able to find out the which bacteria, which parasite is responsible for this anemia. So for the parasitic infection, you can give for the some parasitic drugs for the specific type of infections, maybe the fasciola, maybe the empistomes. In such conditions, you can use specific drugs like the levamisole, niclosamide, then ivermectin, cloxacillin. Then if the tapeworms are there, you can go for the praziquintal. So these are the things can be controlled, the parasitic infection. Then the next is how can we differentiate Babesia from the Leptospira by symptomatically at remote conditions. It is quite difficult, but then you should take help of the laboratory. At least you should go for the blood smear examination. Blood smear examination, and possibly you can go for the urine sample examination. So in urine, you can get the typical, the whorls or the circulatory movements of the Leptospira in case of the urine. Then you can go for the simple Fontana stain. The Fontana stain can be used at the field conditions. It is not much more costly. You can have the some of the chemicals and you can do the Fontana stain, and you must have the microscope at the field level. So it's quite difficult to demonstrate the just only by the symptomatic. Symptomatically, we are not able to differentiate the Leptospira Babesia, but the in Babesia we can get the typical coffee color urine. The high fever is there, and in Leptospira the progressive jaundice is there. That is that kind of jaundice is not observed in case of Babesia, but in Leptospirosis you can give the progressive jaundice, the typical type of yellow discoloration of the mucous membranes, vaginal mucous membranes. Then the sometimes the prad which is coming through the mouth is also yellowish in color. So these are the things you can differentiate, but I will suggest that you should go for the blood smear examination and urine typical movements of the Leptospira, and you can go for the Fontana stain. Then okay, only just looking towards the clinical signs, it's quite difficult, but if you are having some type of difficulty, it's better to give the both the treatment together. So you can give the dimethyl along with the streptopenicillin. So and orally doxycycline, you will get the result from that such conditions. Can we give Abipiran in height of temperature? Yes, if the severe anemic condition is there, you can give the Abipiran in high temperature also, no problem. Can we use Abipiran in dextrose? Yes, dextrose 25% or dextrose 50%. Pure dextrose, pure 25% or pure 50%. If you want to give, it should not be mixed with the other like RL. It should not be mixed. Abipiran should not be mixed with the ringer lactate or other mixtures of the elements. So it should be mixed with the normal saline. No harm is there. You can give in the normal saline, no harm. You can give in dextrose, no harm, but it should not be mixed in the RL or potassium chloride. So it will be precipitate and some adverse reaction may observe. Yes, the temperature we have discussed. Yes, the we are giving the in thalassemia cases, the oxide tetracycline and iron dextran. Yes, we are giving simultaneously, but not in the same bottle. Not in the same bottle. So you can give either oxide tetracycline first, wait for 10-15 minutes, then give the dose of iron dextran intravenously. If you don't want to give intravenously, you can give the intravenously. It doesn't happen anything, or that doesn't matter. Can you give butaphospan intravenously in temperature? Yes, we can give butaphospan in temperature. Whenever there is temperature, we can give the butaphospan intravenously, no problem. Melina, use Okay, so rantidine and pantoprazol we are discussed about 20 ml of H2 blockers we can give for the control of the melena. Yes, panpotin you can give. Okay, so DIC, some question is there. Can you explain DIC? DIC is in the simple language, death is coming. The short form of the same thing is the death is coming. So DIC, it's not, it is funny short form that is made by me, death is coming. But disseminated intravascular coagulopathies, because this disseminated intravascular coagulopathies will lead to the multi-organ failure. There is an accumulation of the complex of the platelets and the antigens, some of the RBCs, some of the leukocytes, they form a clump, and that clump is present in the many capillaries. That lead to the ischemia of the dependent part of the body, and this tissue may die because of the hypoxia. And such type of animals may die after showing some of the symptoms. The symptoms like the itching, then the bleeding tendency throughout the body, maybe in the body cavities, maybe oral cavity, maybe vaginal mucous membranes, then the over the skin, over the abdomen. So these are the typical, then the rashes can be observed. And ultimately, if the DIC is not treated properly, so symptomatic treatment of DIC is the heavy fluids, then the steroids, and the things we should keep in mind that we have to stop the complement activity in the body. So complement activity in body should be stopped by the steroids only. So the steroids can be given in the case of DIC, but the basic cause of DIC we must be find out in such conditions. So DIC can be observed because of the many things. So maybe the tumors, maybe the abscess, maybe the long-standing ischemic condition in body, then the conditions like Ehrlichia, conditions like the anaplasmosis, the other systemic infections, pneumonia, the all conditions which lead to the acute inflammatory reaction may convert it into the disseminated intravascular coagulopathies if we are not able to treat the case in a proper manner. So DIC, basically we can give the fluids, then the steroids, anti-inflammatory drugs, and specific treatment for the specific etiological factor. So this can be controlled, or this could be the answer for the DIC. Then the another question, can we have 30 ml of Arbipiron at a time with the 25? No, we can use the 500 ml of the dextrose. One 10 ml, second 10 ml, third 10 ml. So dextrose 25% into 3, then Arbipiron 10 ml into 3. So not in a single, you can use in the 3 different dextrose. 1, 2, 3. Other than dextrose, we are not using this. So you can use normal saline, you can use dextrose, but no RL, no potassium chloride, no other multi-elemental intravenous solutions. Yes, if you want to give buparvaquone and imidacloprid, you can give simultaneously. No issue into that, because the action of buparvaquone is different, action of imidacloprid is different. Okay, blood smear is already given in the this picture presentation. I will forward the presentation in the different groups, so you will have the blood picture of the protozoas, of the blood protozoas. Okay, one good suggestion has come. So in Leptospira babesia, so in babesia, doctor is saying the light tea black color urine observed in leptospirosis, but unless we have some laboratory investigation, we can't say, but it's a very good observation that the diarrhea is there, but in babesia also diarrhea is there. So not only filaria, not only leptospira, in babesia also you get the diarrhea, but the diarrhea with the having the red color can be observed in the babesia. But it's better to have some conclusions over it. So it's good observation. In under the observation, under the doctor's observation, he's saying that it's my observation. There will be the diarrhea, invariably elevated body temperature by hypothermia. In leptospira, the dung will be always solid. Then temperature elevated, filled by the higher side of the normal range. Urine poppy color in Babesia and light black tea colored in leptospirosis. But along with that, you should go for the you must see the progressive icterus. It is very consistent observation in case of the leptospirosis. Thank you, doctor, for this suggestion. Can we give ranitidine pantoprazole? Yes, you can. No. So there is no mixture. So why it is required? So you can give pantoprazole separately, ranitidine separately. Do not mix. But for veterinary, we don't have such type of combination. So it's better to use separately, because I don't know, because until I have not used both the things together. Okay, so for giving Arbiperon intravenously, you should use the 18 number needle. The first thing is that you should use the 18 number needle instead of using the 16 number needle. So 18 number needle can be used, and the rate of the this is around 8 to 10 drops per ml. Per minute. 8 to 10 drops per minute. So that will give better result. But at field condition, everybody knows that we are using the 60 gauze needle and try to finish the saline within 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 5 minutes. So very fast. Again, we are elevating our hands as much as we can. So such things should be avoided for such type of things. So you should give drop by drop, at least 8 to 10 drops with the help of the 18 gauze needles. Effect of bupivacaine imidacloprid pregnancy. So up till now, such things has not been mentioned, but if the animal is in a very acute anemic conditions, it may lead to abortion as it is. So without giving bupivacaine or imidacloprid, there are chances of abortion, but more chances of abortion can be observed because of the dimethyl acetylate or the RTU. So by giving RTU, there are more chances of abortion, though there is a less though there is no advanced pregnancy. So bupivacaine and imidacloprid means till I am not getting any feedback having the abortion in the by giving bupivacaine or imidacloprid together. Okay, in Babesia, diarrhea followed by constipation. Okay, so these are the your personal things. So it's better. Constipation is there also, no doubt. So you will have constipation, diarrhea, but the color of diarrhea will be reddish one in case of the thalassemia. In case of Babesia. In filaria, thalassemia, blood smear. Okay, so in case of mixed type of infection, so filaria is there, thalassemia is there, as well as the anaplasma is there. So one by one you can treat the case. So you can see which is the most important and which is the most acute. So ultimately, the filaria and anaplasma, they are causing extensive damage to the RBC. So first you should go for the treatment of the filaria and anaplasma, and followed by filarial treatment. Okay, one question, very interesting questions. There is no history of tick infestation since last 3 years till you are getting the blood smear positive for filaria. Yes, it can be happened. So there may be the mechanical transmission of the filaria can be observed, It's not only the tick is responsible for that. So mechanical transmission can be observed. Sometimes our needles may accidentally transmit the disease. Then one of the conditions of the filaria is that once there is a infection or the recent or the transportation is there, so ultimately there are chances of the infections are there. Then after recovery, some of the protozoas, they will retain or they will remain in a dormant stage in the lymph nodes, maybe the superficial lymph nodes or the deep lymph nodes of the body, maybe the mesenteric lymph nodes. And whenever there is a stress to the animal, maybe the stress because of the parturition, maybe the mastitis, maybe the acidosis or the, anything, any kind of stress which lead to the immunosuppression. And once there is a immunosuppression and ultimately there is a chances of the reactivation of the protozoa or the cysts which are present in the lymphocytes, and ultimately you will get the this kind of infections. Even I will give example of the dog also. So the dogs which are staying in the flat system, there is no any chance of the tick infestation, nothing is there till these dogs are having the tick infestation. The reason is this. So the harboring chances are there, and ultimately there are chances of getting the immunosuppression. And once the immunosuppression is there, there is a elevation of the or the activation of the dormant phases of the protozoa. No, we are not using anything into the Arvipiran. Don't mix anything. Only dextrose and Arvipiran. No Avil, no Dexa, nothing should be used in the should be added into the Arvipiran to avoid shock. No. So if you want to give, give separately before giving intravenous iron dextrose. Wait for 10 minutes, then you give the iron dextrose intravenously. But don't mix, like generally we are giving when we are giving the intravenous calcium. So generally we are putting 2 ml of Dexa into that, and then we are giving the intravenously. So don't do that things in the with the help of Arvipiran. So you can give the Arvipiran and dextrose only. Don't mix anything with that. Generally, you can go for 3 days consistent 3 days treatment with the Arvipiran. So ultimately, by giving 1 ml one dose, animal will start eating, or the usual physiological function will start. Okay, for availability, you can call the persons of the Roots Biotech. Can we give Arvipiran in dog IV? But yes, you can give, but hemoglobin level should be very less, so less than 5. Okay, Babesia in dog, which give better result, Dimazine or Imidacarb? So Imidacarb will give better result because it will remain about 11 days in body, and it will having some active activity against the tick fever also. So you can give two treatments together. So Imidacarb will take care of the Babesia as well as the Ehrlichia in case of dog also. Okay, for blood transfusion, you can go for the blood transfusion. The VCBTs are available with you people. If you're not, then you can contact Dr. Chitta, Vikas Chittar. He will able to make supply of the VCBT, and definitely you will get VCBT kits for you people. Then regarding the transfusion, you can go for transfusion whenever there is a very acute type of anemia, and you have to take due proper care of the everything. So matching the major and minor matching, and then go for the blood transfusion. But before that, you should also find out that animal should be healthy, the donor should be healthy one. But if again they in the same flock or they in the same paddock, then there are chances of the infection of the filaria or babesia or in a dormant state. So again, it may enhance the pathology of the particular condition. So you should collect the blood from the healthy donors. Okay. So I think I have given all questions, answer to the all questions. Thank you. Thank you very much to everybody.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful webinar, and hope everyone enjoyed it. Thank you everyone for being here. We appreciate you being here, and see you next time. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Next time,
sir.